Well, good morning. Great to hear that wonderful story. It's great to be able to worship together with a band in the room, the tech people, and several of our elders and staff and council members. So it's been a really good morning already. It's great to have a communion moment with Pastor Inike. Thank you so much for that. And as you're about to find out, he doesn't know exactly what I'm preaching today, but it ties in so beautiful. Thank you so much for that. Thank you, God, for connecting that for us today. Hey, last week we began a new series called A Generous Life, talking about the beauty of giving. And as we discovered a few things last week, we're going to build on those this week. Generosity requires sacrifice. Generosity requires sacrifice. And we challenged you to consider, what does it cost you? What does it cost you in your giving? Not just your money, but your time and your talent and everything. What does it actually cost you? Then we talked about generosity responds to opportunity. We looked at the lady who anointed Jesus' feet with the expensive perfume. And she seized the opportunity that was there right then. When she did that, we discovered that sometimes generosity may receive opposition because not everyone understood what she was doing there. And then we discovered that generosity, by looking at this lady, it actually leaves a legacy. It results in a legacy. She didn't plan on it resulting in a legacy. She just lived a generous life, and that's what followed. And then finally, we ended with generosity releases God's stuff back to him. And as we considered releasing God's stuff back to him, we looked at Abraham and Isaac, and he was willing to sacrifice the son that God had given him. Now, if you missed last week's sermon, please go to the app, go to the website, go to the YouTube channel, go to Facebook, get connected, stay connected, and share that with other people, because there's good news that happens here. There's good news that happens in that space, and people need to know it. And the more you share it, the more people are going to hear it, and they're going to be able to get in on that good news as well. So today, we're going to pick up where we left off last week, talking about releasing back to God what was already his. Have you ever loaned someone something, and it came back different than the way it was when you gave it to them? I remember I loaned a friend a car one time, and it was just for a few hours. He was borrowing my car, and he brought it back, and he said, there was a problem. We had a little accident in a roundabout. He was American, wasn't used to Australia, and there was a piece of my car that had fallen off, and he brought it back to me and handed me the piece of my car. I was like, thanks, mate, and that was end of story. It's like, oh, okay, thanks. So, yeah, what would you have thought? I look at my bookshelves sometimes, and my bookshelves have gotten smaller and smaller and smaller over the years. A few of them I have culled myself because I don't need that anymore, pass it on to someone else. But as I look at my bookshelves, sometimes I've got books that I know I have. I know I didn't cull, and I go to get the book, and it's not there because I've lent it to someone, and it never came back. How does stuff like that make you feel? If you're like me, I think that we would all agree that when we borrow something from someone, we want to give it back as good or better than when we took it. And if we are on the other end of that, we expect or we would like for others to bring stuff back to us as good as what we gave it to them. Why do we feel that way? It's because we have a relationship with our stuff. Do you know that? Do you know you have a relationship with your stuff? If you doubt that, think about the emotions that came up, the thoughts that you had when I just shared those few illustrations. We have a relationship with our stuff. And if we are going to live a generous life, then we need to properly understand that relationship with our stuff. You see, our stuff, our money, our friends, our family, our kids, our parents, all of those things we treat as possessions because we love them and we care for them. But our relationship with our resources is actually this right here. Our relationship with our resources is that we actually are not the owners. We are stewards. We steward what God has given us. And we're going to unpack that principle here this morning. Now, a steward, that's not a word that we use every day, but a steward in biblical terms means it's a manager or an overseer, a superintendent of another person's household, somebody who cares for somebody else's stuff. That's what a steward is. And the Bible in many, many places talks about us being stewards. So we're going to unpack that now, and we're going to see it's a principle that's not new to our generation. It's not even just a New Testament principle. Over 3,000 years ago, there was a guy called David. David was the king of Israel, and David's journey to be the king of Israel was not an easy one. It was quite a difficult one. But he finally had taken over. He was leading Israel, and Israel had lived in tents, and they had worshiped in a portable tabernacle. And they had many wars and everything. And then there came a day where David had actually arrived. He had reached the pinnacle, if you will. All the enemies had been defeated, and David was living in a palace. It was a beautiful palace. And he looked out, and he decided, hey, there's something wrong here. I'm living in this palace, and God is still being worshiped in this portable tabernacle. So he decided that he was going to design and build a temple that was befitting the creator of the universe. So he went into the national treasury, and then he gave some of his own money. Some scholars say of his own money, they estimate he gave about $14 billion of his own money. Now, I don't get that at all. I can't even fathom that much money in my head. But he gave that. And then he challenged everyone else, hey, it's not just me, it's not just the national treasury, I want you all to get involved here. And they did. They gave generously. And look what it says here in 1 Chronicles chapter 29 and verse 9. It says, they rejoiced because they had given freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. They had a party because they were able to give. That was exciting for them. They gave, and this great thing was accomplished, and they had a party. They celebrated. So, and then David prayed, and in his prayer, we learn this principle about us not being owners, but us being stewards. In verse 10, it says this, then David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly. O Lord, the God of our ancestor Israel, may you be praised forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. See, David looked at the situation, and his assessment was what had just happened. All the funds that had come in to build this temple was all about God. It wasn't about the people that were giving. It wasn't about his generosity even. It was all about God. Now, I want you to remember, David is the king of Israel, and Israel is the greatest superpower on the planet at this stage. But he understood that it was all about God and not about him. In verse 11, he says this, everything in the heavens and on earth is yours, O Lord. Wealth and honor come from you alone, for you rule over everything. He's doubling down on that. It's all about God. You own everything. God owns everything. We have to start, when we think about living a generous life, we have to start with this principle that God owns everything. We have to start right there. If we don't start there, you're going to get tripped up. You're going to stumble. You're not going to be able to apply these things about living a generous life. We can't live a generous life until we start with God owns everything. Okay? So start there in your thinking. Retrain your brain right now. That was David's perspective, is that it was all God's to start with. They were just moving the resources of God's to another place to do another thing. They had been directed by God, and they said, okay, here's God's stuff. Oh, I don't have my wallet on me, but here's God's stuff, and I'm going to move that over here and reallocate it for God's purposes, for God's plan. David was saying, everything that makes this life enjoyable, everything that enables us to do anything comes from God. Now, for those that were listening in to David's prayer, this might have been a little bit shocking to them because they had journeyed with David. They loved David as their king, and they had seen him lead them in battle. They had seen the sacrifices that he had made. They had seen the difficult journey that he had been on to get there and the hard work that he had done. And then David said, but it's all about God. He did not even see himself as worthy to be called generous. A few years back in the U.S., there was a big campaign that went on. The president of the time made a big statement about, you didn't build this, okay? And everybody in America got up in arms, not everybody, the half that didn't like what he said got up in arms. And there was bumper stickers and campaigns and people wearing hats and t-shirts that, I built this. You know, they were proud of their businesses and all the hard work they had done and everything. And I get the sentiment because it was a big political fiasco going on and everything. And they wanted to say, you know, my blood, sweat, and tears did build this business and all that. But David could have said that. Yes, I built this. I led this. I did this. But he was humble and he said, no, no, it's all about God. Look what he said in verse 13. It says, our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name. But who am I and who are my people that we could give anything to you? Everything we have has come from you. And we give you only what you first gave us. David understood that God provides even the things that we give. God provides what we give. He understood that what everyone had just given and what he had just given, it all started out as God's anyway, and they released it back. Paul brings this out in the New Testament as well. In Romans chapter 11, it says this. Romans 11 and verse 35. And who has given him so much that he needs to pay it back? For everything comes from him. Everything exists by his power and is intended for his glory. All glory to him forever. Amen. So God is the source of everything. God supplies everything. And if that is true, it's an Old Testament principle that we saw in David. Paul reiterates it in the New Testament. If all of that is true, what is our response? Look at what he says in chapter 12, verse 1, following on for there. Therefore, because everything we have comes from him, I urge you, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Paul teaches us that because everything comes from God to start with, it's all his. Everything that we give even came from him. We need to offer all we have back to him as a sacrifice, a living sacrifice, he calls it. And then he says, don't be conformed to the pattern of the world. Okay, that means we're going to have to change our thinking. Some of the things I've already said today is actually shaking you a little bit. It's making you uncomfortable to think that it's all God's and he owns everything and I didn't build this. And you need to start getting ready to change that thinking. That's the thinking like the world. He says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So we start with changing our mindset that we're not owners, we are stewards. It's a change of thinking. And when we start with that, it's strange thinking. You know, as I look back across our lives, there's been some landmark moments that have driven home some of these principles to us. When our youngest daughter, Jill, was born, Deanna was in hospital, and she got really, really sick really, really quick. They sent her home with the baby and everything with Jill, and then immediately, with a couple hours, we were back in the hospital because she was literally in heart failure, and there was a couple of moments over 9 days period that we actually didn't think she was going to make it through. One of those particular nights when it was probably at its peak and at its worst, Deanna reflects that she had a moment where she realized that her life was God's. And if she died, that was okay. And see, we were also in the process of considering, are we coming to Australia, leaving America to come to Australia? Because we felt God leading that. And that was a landmark moment for her to realize that even my own life is God's. 2 years later, that same daughter, Jill, It was around Christmas time, and we had folks over and everything. And we lived on a really busy road, and cars would go by probably at about 70, 80 kilometers per hour in front of our house. And Deanna was across the street. She had walked across the street to feed the neighbor's animals because they were away on holidays for Christmas. And she got to the door, and then we heard a car screeching its brakes. We saw Jill standing in the middle of the road, and then we literally heard thump, thump, and the car was in the ditch. In that moment, we believed we had just lost our daughter. I have no idea what happened in that moment, but Jill was in my mother's arms in our front yard when it was all over. I can't tell you today how that happened. I believe it was God's intervention. God protected her. But we realized at that time, even our children's lives, if we're going to sacrifice, if we're going to move around the world and all of that, our children's lives are in his hands too. They are his, not ours. We are stewards, not owners. Bringing it back to talking about giving, and we're going to talk about the church. If you've been in church life very long, you've probably heard the word tithing. And if you're not familiar with that language, the word tithe means 10%. Now, I generally avoid using that word. I don't really like that word, and there's a couple of reasons. First of all, a tithe, that 10% giving principle, which it's a principle, is that it's just that. It's a principle. It's not a mandate that Jesus has laid upon us. He hasn't given us that as a mandate. Okay, and before you get excited and say, woohoo, I don't have to give 10%. And by the way, if that's a conviction for you and you've decided 10% is what you should give, then good on you. Keep doing that. But the second part of this that I'm uncomfortable with is that when we treat the 10% giving as a law, what that does for us mentally is it fosters the mentality that this is my money. And I'm giving God 10% of my money. Okay, you see the trick there? That we would end up playing on ourselves, thinking that it's ours anyway. If I give God 10%, then I can do whatever I want with the other 90%. Woohoo! And some of you aren't even giving 10%, and you're like, I'm going to do whatever I want with the whole 100%. Friends, you're stewards, not owners. We are stewards. We are not owners. I want you to think it through. God provides you with everything. And here's normal thinking. Normal life thinking is this when it comes to giving. How much of my money will I give him? That's the question that we're all faced with or that we all wrestle with and we try to decide. How much of my money will I give him? But if we start with, I'm a steward, not an owner. It's not my money. God owns it. Then we're going to flip that question. We're going to ask a different question. We're going to ask, how will I use the resources he provides to honor him? It's a very different question. And I would submit to you, we probably come up with a very different answer when we ask it that way, when we understand that we are not owners, we are stewards. We only manage his resources. So to help you understand this principle even a little bit further, I'm going to share from Matthew chapter 25. Matthew was a tax collector, and he met Jesus and started following Jesus, and his life was transformed, and his attitude about money changed, and all of this. And I'm going to just share with you a familiar story. We're not even going to read it. But Matthew tells a story. He said, there was a man, and this man is representative of God. And this man went to a far country. He took a trip, and he left with three of his servants his money. He gave one servant five bags of silver, one servant two bags of silver, and the last servant one bag of silver. Now, spoiler alert, he knew what he was doing in only giving that guy one, okay? So, a bag of silver was worth about 15 to 20 years' wages. So even the one that got one had a lot of responsibility there. So the guy that he gave five went out and he doubled it. The guy that he gave two doubled it as well. And the third one went and buried the one bag in the dirt. So the owner comes back and the owner sees the guy that had five and the guy that had five gave him 10, said, hey, I took your money. I invested it. I doubled your money. The owner said, great job, let's have a party. That's amazing. Same thing happened with the second guy. Two bags, here's four. Great job, well done. The third guy comes back and he dusts off the money that was in the dirt and he gives it back to him. And he said, hey, here's your money back. I was actually afraid I would lose your money if I did anything with it. So I just hid it in the dirt to protect it. And the owner said, you're a wicked servant. You should have at least put it in the bank and got 0.775% interest on it. Right, right. If you're not in Australia, that's where we're at right now. I think that actually might be high. But the owner said, no. You got that wrong. If you knew that I would expect more than that, and I would get angry about it, why didn't you do something better with my money? So what's the point of this whole story? Two questions. First of all, what percentage of the man's money was his money? What percentage of the man that took the trip of his money was his money? Type it in the chat. What percentage? What? Go ahead. And if you're in the room, yell it out. What percentage? This is not a trick question. The man who took the trip. Hey, 100%. Okay, say with me, guys. Okay, you just took a nap in between there in the story. All right, 100%. All right, here we go. This one will be a little bit easier. What percentage of the man's money that took the trip was the servant's money? 0%. Good job. There was nothing left. Yeah, that was a freebie there for you. So the mentality was that the servants were not the owners. They were just the money managers. So that story illustrates for you and I, the resources God gives us, that's how we need to treat them. They're not ours. They are His. We are managers of those resources. One more illustration to kind of help you unpack this a little bit more in your brain there. Some of you might have a financial planner or a money manager that takes your investments and does that. Anybody got those people in your life? Yep. A few of you, yep. Okay. So you give them your money. You entrust that to them. You expect them to manage it for you, and you expect a good result. You tell them what your appetite for risk is and all of that. And I've heard, I don't do this stuff because I don't have any money. But anyway, this is all God's. But you tell them what the results you want are, and then you expect them to get those results for you. So imagine, at the end of the year, your financial manager gives you a report on how your money did. And he or she says, hey, I took 10% of your money and I invested it over here. I doubled that. You'd be like, woo, good job. Why didn't you do more, right? And then he says, but then, you know, I needed a new iPhone, I needed a new car, and I wanted a bigger house. So I took some of your money and I actually used it for myself. Now that's called fees. And those are exorbitant fees, by the way, that I just described. But then he says, and 50% of your money went to miscellaneous. I can't tell you where 50% of your money went. Now, what are you going to do? How are you going to feel about your financial planner, your finance manager? You're going to go find a new one, aren't you? And you may be in court with that guy. But that's a whole nother conversation for another day. But you're not going to be happy with the way he managed your money. Now, friends, acknowledging God as the owner of everything and seeing ourselves as stewards of His resources is not something that is easy for us to get our heads around. It's not something that's easy for us to apply in our daily lives, and especially in our wealthy context of Western nations. We have great difficulty coming to grips with this. Matthew chapter 19 tells another story about a rich man who struggled with this. It says this, behold, a man came up to him saying, teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life? And he said to him, why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you would enter life, keep the commandments. He said to him, which ones? That's key. Jesus said, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your father and mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The young man said to him, All these I have kept. What do I still lack? Jesus said to him, if you would be perfect, go sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me. He said, which one? Which commandment? Jesus gave him a list of all the six. And the man said, but what else? Is there anything else? And then he comes to the heart of the matter for the man. He said, if you want to be perfect, that word perfect means mature or complete. Mature or complete. Our relationship with our money and our stuff. It's a discipleship issue. It's a maturity issue. Friends, when we struggle with this, and I'm saying we struggle with this, okay, because we all do, and we all will as long as we're on this planet, because money is so powerful. We'll talk about that next week. But friends, this is a spiritual maturity issue that we have to wrestle with and grow in continually. Jesus even admitted how difficult it is in verse 23. He says, Jesus said to his disciples, truly I say to you, only with difficulty will a rich person enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. I've always loved that analogy, the camel through the eye of a needle. And there's some people that have tried to explain that away. There's a place called the eye of the needle and camels could actually go through there, but it's hard or whatever. I don't believe that. I think Jesus meant a camel through the eye of a needle. And when we think about this, this isn't like a Rubik's Cube puzzle or one of those tricky little things that we do, that we love the gadgets that we can show we're smarter than everybody else because we figured it out. You're not going to get a camel through the eye of a needle. Full stop. It's not gonna happen. And the disciples understood that. It says, when the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished, saying, who then can be saved? But Jesus looked at them and said, with man, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Jesus said, impossible? Yeah, it looks like it, but God. Everything's possible with God. Is it hard? And is this principle about the finances that we're talking about, is that hard? Is the principle about giving our lives back as a living sacrifice, is it hard? Yes, it's hard, but God. We need God's strength to do that. And before we move on from this, I'm going to give you another little sermonette here. It's actually a side thought, but it's so important because when we look at with God, all things are possible, friends, we need to believe that with God, all things are possible. I don't know what's impossible in your life right now, but we've all got something, and you just thought of something right now. What is impossible in your life? Maybe it has to do with your relationships. Maybe it has to do with health. Maybe it's something to do with your finances or a loved one who isn't following Jesus and things like that. Whatever it is for you, what is your impossible? Friends, what you're defining as impossible right now is possible with God. God can do anything. That's where our faith comes in, our trust comes in. We have to trust God to do the impossible. God wants us to trust him for the impossible. Jesus says that you have to have faith like a child, okay, if you're gonna enter the kingdom. And children believe the impossible. Children don't assess whether something can happen or not. Last week, Deanna shared a story about Grant and one of our kids giving. He won this money and he gave it all. And he actually told his mom later, he said, actually, that's not how it went. I had birthday money before that. And I gave all of my birthday money. And then I got back because I won the thing. Go back and listen to last week's service if you need the context for that. Also, another story. I remember Jill, when we came to Australia, then we left Australia for 2 years. And when we were leaving Australia, we did not want to leave Australia. But we sensed God leading it, and we kept trying to make the assessments and all the reasons that's not what was really happening, why that felt impossible for us. It felt like something that would just not be in the cards. And our 10-year-old daughter at the time told me one day, she said, Dad, I'm not a complicated intelligence kind of person, but it sure seems like that's what God wants us to do, right? She wasn't a complicated intelligence kind of person. She didn't have the filters to assess why that shouldn't happen and couldn't happen. She just believed that that's what was going to happen because she trusted in God's leading. You see, we need to have big faith, friends. As a church, we need to have big faith. What God has done here over the last 50-something years is amazing. And it's all about God. It's not about all the people. We thank people all the time and we appreciate people's giving, but it's all God. And friends, what we see here, it seems like this is a beautiful corner, beautiful buildings. We've got a beautiful streaming service and all this stuff, and we're reaching around the world now. But that's not where God wants to stop. God wants us to keep going. We're in the immediate, we're faced with something that looks a little bit impossible. I gave you a challenge last week that we want to raise $75,000 above and beyond our normal giving over the rest of the year, before the end of the year, so we can balance the budget. And friends, when I gave you that challenge, I look at that as impossible. I look at that as, anyway. But with God, it's possible. And I ask you to do it. You know what else I'm doing? I'm asking God to do it. Because I can ask you all day long, I can inform you, but it's up to God to actually come through with it. God wants us to believe him for the impossible. That's the side note. So, big takeaway day. Let's bring this back to us talking about we are not owners, we are stewards. So, as money managers, friends, get this. We need to be knowing where the money is going, okay? If you're managing God's resources, you need to know where it's going. You got to start with that, or else you're not going to be able to be a good steward of it if you have no idea where it's going. So if I ask you where you spend your money, some of you would know. Some of you would have spreadsheets, and you say, look, I can show you every cent that I've spent over the last 20 years. Good on you. That's great. Most of you couldn't tell yourself, much less tell me, where you spent all your money or all of God's money, let's say. We need a plan to track. And I'm not talking about a budget. Budgets are okay, but I find budgets a little bit annoying because it's a prediction of the future, and none of us can really predict the future, but we try, and then we put that in a drawer somewhere or file it away on our computer, and we never look at it again. But this is something, the tracking is something that we can do right now. Why should you track it? Well, because it will inform you about what you're doing. I have this thing on my wrist that's a tracker. It tells how many steps I take and how much I exercise. And I've got another app on my phone that I can log what I eat and everything. Why would I do those things? Because if I'm tracking it, then I'm accountable. If I'm tracking it, then it's telling me what I'm doing and it makes me conscious of that thing. And it inspires me to do a better job of it. It inspires me. I don't want to not close my rings. If I don't close my rings, I failed that day in my head. And I fail a couple times a week usually. But it helps you identify the reality. And tracking your finances will help you identify the reality of how you spend it. It will be confronting. So the challenge this week is to track your spending for the next 30 days. And I want you to document it. We've got a resource on the website there. There's the address, WerribeeBaptist.org/AU, balance the budget. There's a resource there for you can track that. If you want to do it on paper, if you've got another app on your phone, there's billions of ways you can track your billions of dollars. But track every time you spend money. Your bills, your mortgage, your rent, your coffees, the other coffee, lunches, dinners. So track that. Track it for 30 days. And then at the end of 30 days, look at it. You actually might be pleased when you see what comes back. But evaluate it. As you look at it, evaluate it. You may be excited, you may be surprised. But if you're not, if you see something there you don't like, adjust it. And then you're knowing where the money is going. And you can be a good steward of the resources God has given you. Now, this is a very practical application today. And some of you may be thinking, well, hang on a minute, is this church? You know, that's not spiritual, friends. Change your thinking. We are stewards, not owners. It's very spiritual for us to know where our money's going and how we're using that for his kingdom purposes. We need to be careful about isolating our spiritual life from our everyday life because those need to be intertwined and everything that we do needs to be done to honor him. So in closing, Just a reminder, we're managers, we're not owners. God is the owner. He's entrusted tremendous resources to us. And friends, we'll talk about this probably next week, but as people in Australia, I'm talking to the ones in Australia right now, and you in America too, he has given you so much, so many resources. He's entrusted those to you. How are you going to manage what he's entrusted? Not how much am I going to give back to him, but how will I manage all the resources he has given me? And then make a start today by finding out. Father, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the principles here about stewardship. Lord, thank you for reminding us that you own everything, and Lord, that we are only stewards of the things that you entrust to us. Help us to be good stewards. Help us to, Lord, not push back on this concept. Help us to embrace it. And Lord, where we need to apply that to our lives, where we need to change our view, we need to change our relationship with money and stuff, and even our very lives. Empower us by your strength. Lord, these are big asks, but they're from you. And for some of us, it may even seem impossible to trust you that much. But Lord, we lean into you because you say, if we think it's impossible, all things are possible with you. Thank you, Jesus, in whose name we pray.